my name is Camille Becerra. I'm a chef here in New York City.
You're about to learn in my first cook-along how to cook the vegetarian dragon bowl,
which is based on a classic macrobiotic bowl that had its moment in the 70s.
Cooking is my passion, and I'm so excited to share with you the very best way to cook this delicious meal. You'll be able to learn a lot of different techniques, from pickling, roasting nuts and seeds, roasting vegetables, the Japanese cutting technique, poaching eggs. I love going to this spice market. Ataf, the owner, is one of my favorite people in all the lands.
Hi, Ataf!
Hi, Chef!
Just take your time and enjoy. The end product is gonna be a delicious, healthful bowl.
Hi, my name is Camille Becerra. I'm a chef here in New York City.
Camille's first job was preparing food for the monks in a monastery in California. They taught her all she needed to know about spices and good vibes. Camille moved to Brooklyn and opened her very own restaurant. She called it Paloma, but Paloma was destroyed in a fire. So Camille entered Top Chef and did very well. So well, in fact, she opened a seafood restaurant in Soho, Navy. But soon adventure beckoned. She hosted successful pop-up after pop-up, and it was at the Cafe Henry pop-up where the Dragon Bowl was born.
Cafe Henry is a downtown cafe that brings in a bunch of different artists and creatives from the neighborhood. So at Henry, the concept that we came up with was a dragon bowl, which is based on a classic macrobiotic bowl that had its moment in the 70s, and we decided to just bring it back and sort of make it more modern and colorful.
And now, the 1970s trend of the dragon bowl is becoming a national sensation. The Dragon Bowl is magical because it gives you everything you need in your diet. 25% whole grains, 25% vegetables, 25% extras, 15% protein, and 10% sauce.
You're about to learn in my first cook-along how to cook one of my favorite meals, the vegetarian Dragon Bowl. Cooking is my passion, and I'm so excited to share with you the very best way to cook this delicious meal.
There are 7 steps to the Dragon Bowl,
and should take about an hour to prepare. Midway through, we have some time to wait for the rice to cook. While we're waiting, I've prepared a video for you to watch. Okay, let's get started. So the first thing we need to do before we begin is to gather all of the ingredients and tools we will need. Proper preparation is everything, and in a professional kitchen, it's called mise en place. Having everything you need laid out in place. For the Dragon Bowl, you'll need these tools. Rice cooker, sheet pan, spice grinder. We have a small saute pan, a small sauce pot. This one is copper. Of course, a stainless steel is always another option. A 3-quart sauce pot, a petit knife, 1 cutting board, kitchen shears, measuring cups, and measuring spoons. Blender, mixing bowls, metal spoon, parchment paper, strainer, slotted spoon, can opener, a mandolin, a timer. For the Dragon Bowl, you will need these ingredients. Long grain brown rice, eggs, red quinoa, shredded coconut, unsweetened coconut milk, carrots, chili powder, some salt, whole black pepper, honey,
white distilled vinegar, sugar, red beets, dried goji berries. Dried goji berries are high in antioxidants. They have more iron than spinach. They're very sweet and slightly tart. Grapeseed oil. Grapeseed oil is a neutral oil that is great for any application. Pumpkin seeds, sunflower seeds, chili de arbol. Chili de arbol is a delicious chili that will be buzzing for our harissa. Turmeric, whole coriander seed. As an alternative, you can use ground corianders. Whole cumin seed. As well, you can use ground cumin seed as an alternative. Cooked garbanzo beans, also found in a can. Watermelon radish is a very bright pink radish in the inside. It just brings a lot of color and vibrancy to your dish. Mixed greens. Red cabbage. Mixed sprouts. Whole milk, plain yogurt, sweet potato, lemon. For garnishing, we have some edible flowers. These in particular are broccoli rabe. Other options for edible flowers are nasturtiums. Squash blossoms are another option. And some herbs. This is sorrel. These are optional. You can use whatever kind of herbs you want and whatever edible blossoms and flowers you find. There are 7 steps to the Dragon Bowl. Step 1, preheat the oven and cook coconut greens. 2, roast vegetables. 3, make a pickle, toast your seeds or nuts. Arrange all our garnishes for our Dragon Bowl. Step 4, start boiling your water. Step 5, make your carrot harissa yogurt. Season your garbanzos. Step 6, poach turmeric eggs. Step 7, assemble. Just take your time and enjoy. The end product is going to be a delicious, healthful bowl. Step 1, we're going to preheat the oven and cook coconut greens. We're going to preheat the oven to 400 degrees. So let's start with our coconut greens. We're going to use a rice cooker. If you don't have a rice cooker, you can use a pot. Just add everything into your bowl or rice cooker. So we're going to start with some long grain brown rice. We're going to use quinoa, desiccated coconut, 1 can of coconut milk, unsweetened, incorporating coconut. It's very healthful and so delicious. It adds such a wonderful dimension to grains. And some salt. Give that a stir so that everything is well incorporated. Now, if you're using a pot, what you're going to do is you're going to bring all these ingredients to a boil, cover it, lower the temperature so that it's just at a simmer, and set a timer. If you're using a rice cooker, you're just going to press play, and when they're done, it turns itself off. I'm using a rice cooker, so I just, again, want to make sure everything is well incorporated. Put the lid on it and set it in the rice cooker. Step 2, roasting our vegetables. So when I roast vegetables, I basically use the same ingredients all the time because I know it's a sure bet. So today we're going to be roasting some sweet potato. The roasted sweet potato is going to be one of the vegetables in our bowl, as well as we're going to roast some carrots, and the carrots will be roasted with some honey, salt, chili, and those are going to be pureed and made into our carrot harissa yogurt. That'll be the sauce for our bowl. So when cutting vegetables for roasting, I like to use the Japanese technique where you do sort of an oblique cut, and by just rolling your vegetables with every cut and cutting it on a slanted motion, what you're doing is you're giving the vegetable a lot of surface. And what happens is the vegetable cooks faster and it retains a lot of the minerals because of its short cooking period. Again, so you're doing a roll and cut on a slant, roll and cut on a slant. It may need a little bit of practice, but this is a technique that you should do for most every vegetable that you roast. Plus it gives it a nice kind of cool shape that I think is very interesting. Once you have your vegetables cut, you're gonna toss them in olive oil, salt, chili, and honey. What the honey does is it helps the natural sweetness of the vegetables come out. So here we go. We have our carrots. We're gonna just add a little drizzle of oil. This is gonna help coat the vegetables and have all this great seasoning cling to it. Some salt. A pinch of chili. You'll find that in this recipe and in most of my cooking, I always use a little bit of chili. This is not to make a spicy dish. What it does is it acts to waking up the taste buds. And then it also creates that sort of delicious lingering flavor on your palate that is just so good when once you've eaten a really delicious meal. So take a spoon. Make sure that all the vegetables are coated. I want to just add the smallest little drizzle of honey. Again, this is not to make your vegetables sweet. It's just, it acts as a little nudge to bring out the sweetness in root vegetables. So we're gonna roast both vegetables together. Because they're for two different applications, I wanna put them on the same tray, but on two separate sides. So we'll add the carrots here. And then we're gonna do the same thing with our sweet potato. Cut it lengthwise. And then as much as you can, do your roll and cut. And cut on an angle. Put those in and do the other half. Roll and cut. Remember, you're cutting on an angle so that basically each vegetable has more than four sides. You can usually get five or six sides out of it. So again, we're gonna drizzle with a little bit of grape seed oil just to coat everything. Some salt, and I like to sprinkle salt and herbs from a little bit higher just so that it reaches all points of the bowl. Dash of chili. And something sweet. Give this a whirl. Make sure everything's coated. Sometimes some root vegetables sort of absorb ingredients more than others. Potatoes generally do that. So if you find that they're a little too dry, just add a little bit more oil. And sometimes I just, if you're uncertain if it's seasoned enough, what I like to do is give it a little taste. If you can taste the salt, then you're all good. Put it on the opposite side of the roasting pan, and then you're gonna pop this in that preheated 400 degree oven for about 20 to 25 minutes. So, I think that it's also very important when you finish one step to kind of look at your area and put whatever is dirty or garbage, toss it away so that you're always working with a clean work area. I think that's really important. While the vegetables are roasting and the rice is cooking, we're gonna take a short break and show you a little documentary piece that I made about the farmers market and one of my favorite spice markets in New York and basically in all the world.
Ah, the farmers market, a feast of the senses. And where chefs go to make a sensible feast. Camille knows best.
You can mix and match ingredients that you're craving at the moment or ingredients that look really great at the market that you want to use.
Always bring cash. There's fun, there's flavor, and there's whatever the f*** this is. Seriously, what is that? Having collected her final ingredient, the delectable carrot, Camille is done here for today. But there is still much remaining for the Dragon Bowl, and for that, she must venture to the other side of town.
Oh, yeah. I love going to this spice market in the East Village. Ataf, the owner, is one of my favorite people in all the lands.
For chefs like Camille, there is no place on earth like the spice market.
How are you? Oh, it's so good to see you.
Nice to see you. You look beautiful.
So I'm making a dragon bowl.
Nice.
I'm going to need a little bit of the regular cumin, coriander,
sure.
And some turmeric.
Cumin seed from South Asia, North Africa, and Latin America has an earthy, warm feeling. Plus, ancient Egyptians used it to mummify their deceased pharaohs. Coriander, otherwise known as cilantro, is a multifaceted ingredient, known as a leaf, a seed, and a spice. The use of coriander can be traced back 5,000 years ago, making it one of the world's oldest spices. Turmeric is really trendy right now. It's a medicine, a dye, and a spice, but it turns things yellow, which is why you shouldn't get it on your clothes, especially if you're wearing white.
Hello. You must have the turmeric. Turmeric is the spices. I had beautiful,
look at this beautiful
turmeric just arrived.
Yellow. It almost
from
looks
Madagascar.
Like
this.
Awesome.
Is the cumin.
Awesome.
So should I give you half of this or?
Actually, if we can have a little bit of whole.
Sure.
Cumin and whole
of
coriander.
Course. I think awesome. You should try this
yes.
Turmeric is amazing.
Mm.
I always offer you ground spices, but you tell me whole. And I love that about it because I know that you're gonna grind it and you're gonna toast it. Turmeric became like really these spices to cure so many things.
Yes.
So there's a health conscious and there is really a trend of turmeric. People realize that turmeric not only a great things for your food, but also you can heal your customer at the same time.
Yes.
And I think that's really the magic, what is it?
It's got a great freshness to it, mm-hmm. and a beautiful sort of tartness.
Sure. I mean, spices is really, you know, it's different when you have a spice that sits there for 2 weeks and a spice that sits there for 6 months.
Yes.
And it changes the whole spectrum of using a spice, you know.
Right.
I love, you know, the fact that you not only you want to do a beautiful dish for your customer, but you really want to have, want them to have the access to the same product that you do. So that shows the humility in your kitchen and
that
beautiful soul of you, of yours. So I really compliment you.
Oh, thank you. When I'm taking pictures, it all has to do with where the beautiful, pretty light is. So there's some beautiful light streaming through here. I don't generally like a picture that has a lot of filters on it. Like, I love to keep it as natural as possible. So then I'll play around with it, and then I'll upload it to Instagram, tag where I'm at. I always try and give people a little bit of information about like my life and how that relates to food and travel or food in New York City. Oh. And then always when I come here, I always get a really sweet treat.
A ginger juice.
It's ginger juice, which is so great.
Now you've seen how Camille prepares for her Dragon Ball, it's time to prepare for yours. Here's to life, here's to flavor, and here's to the return of the 1970s in the form of a delicious feast.
Welcome back. I hope you enjoyed hanging out with me at some of my favorite spots in New York City, the Green Market in all its glory, and the wonderful SOS Spice Market, and meeting a chef. And I hope that you pulled away that it's so important to make those contacts and with different vendors. I think that they have so much information and they're so inspirational. So I'm gonna check my vegetables that are roasting.
So when you're testing vegetables, you just want to give them a little tap, and you want to feel that they're soft within. These definitely need a little bit more time.
Step three, make a pickle. Toast your seeds or nuts. Arrange all our garnishes for our dragon bowl.
We're gonna make some pickles. So I think that with these pickles, they're beautiful. They're gonna add so much flavor and brightness to the dish and so much color. But of course, if you have some pickles at home, though, you can use those definitely. Chop them up and use them. But I definitely encourage you to try your hand at some pickles. So we're going to start by making our pickling solution. So we're gonna grab a little saucepan. This one's copper. Copper is great because it heats up really fast and it distributes heat very evenly. So we're gonna start with a little bit of vinegar. And what we're doing is we're adding vinegar, sugar, and water. And what that does is sort of balances the tartness of the vinegar so that it's balanced and it's not like so puckery. We're gonna add a little bit of sugar and some salt. We're gonna put that on the heat, sort of at a medium flame. And we're gonna stir it occasionally so that the sugar on the bottom dissolves. While that's warming up, and what we really wanna have that come to a full boil. We're going to, in a bowl, prep out our pickling ingredients. We're gonna use goji berries. Goji berries are wonderful. They are a superfood. They have so much antioxidants in them, and they taste delicious. They're tart and sweet. And then we're gonna use some beets. I think the color combination of the gojis being really red, and then the purple qualities of the beet are gonna play really well together. So we're going to take our mandoline, and you always wanna just use extra caution when you're using one. These are great to have, and I use them for everything. I shave vegetables for salads, etc. So for this, we're gonna just slice a little bit of the beets. When you're using a mandolin, you always wanna use your palm and kind of keep your fingertips far from the blade. So you're just gonna slightly swipe the beet down. You don't need that much. Of course, if you're into it, you can make a big batch and just keep it in your refrigerator and just pull every time you want a little pickled something on your dish. Great on salads, etc. Even as a relish for a steak or chicken. So you're going to add your beets to your gojis. And then I'm gonna check on my pickling solution. Still needs a little more time. You definitely wanna have your pickling solution come to a full boil. In the meantime, we are going to also bring and utilize some seeds. So seeds are a great source of protein, but in terms of flavor, they have such a great nuttiness, sort of crunchiness to them. So I always, always love to use some type of nut or seed variety. I'm gonna grab a saute pan and I'm gonna put a little bit of oil in it. Not too much, it's basically just to sort of cover the bottom of the saute pan. Again, this is something that if you want to make a big batch of and just keep it in your pantry, so every time you're making a bowl or a salad, or even some type of porridge you can pull from this. And I think that's a really important thing for home cooks, is to develop a great pantry so that you're always just kind of inspired to make your own creations based on what you have in your pantry. So for here, I'm going to use a little bit of salt and some chili powder. I'm gonna put this on the fire, and I'm gonna keep an eye on it and continuously shake them around, because once they get going, they will burn really quickly. At this point, my pickling solution is now boiling, and I'm going to pour it straight into the goji and beets. And by the time everything's done, these will be nice and pickled, they'll have great flavor, and the gojis will be nice and plump. So over here, on high heat, I'm gonna start my seeds. Feel free to use whatever nuts or seeds you want. You can use pecans or almonds. And I find that this is a great way of toasting it. Sometimes people will put them in the oven and I feel like you sort of lose your connection to them and they have the chance of burning more times than not. So with here, you're like connected, you're watching them. They really go from light to dark really quickly. So I'm just gonna keep on them and I'm not gonna move away until they're perfect. Once the oil gets hot, they go really quickly. While I'm here, I'll give my vegetables a check. They're looking really good. I would say another few minutes. Keep shaking them. They're gonna start sort of talking to you. They're gonna start sort of making this like sizzly popping noise. And you're gonna get some great aroma from them. Really nutty and spicy aromas. Now you could keep moving your pan around, or you can very easily take a spoon and just move them around. They're almost done. They're already sort of like a golden brown. Just kind of really bring out that nuttiness. At this point, you definitely want to keep shaking, stirring, definitely. Do not check your text messages at this point. They're almost ready. Beautiful color, nice and golden. I'm gonna transfer them quickly into a bowl, as if they stay in the pan, they can actually eventually burn. Great. I'm gonna take a paper towel and just quickly just wipe that off. I'm gonna check my vegetables. They're looking super good, almost there. I'm just gonna sort of flip them around, toss them a little bit. They're gonna take another few minutes. They're very close to being there. Great. Now, let's keep on working on some garnishes. So We're going to also have some raw vegetables. I think they not only add some like very crisp and crunchy vibe to the salad, but I think that if you're using sort of bright colors, it also gives it a beautiful sort of palette to the entire bowl. So I'm gonna just take a little bit off of this red cabbage. Cabbage goes a long way, and you can use it in so many applications. You can shred it into salads, you can make a delicious slaw, or mix it with greens. But I do also love a sauteed cabbage with some rice, etc. And then I'm going to use a mandolin for this as well. Rinse off your mandolin so you can use it again. Shave them fairly thin. And as you get closer, you definitely want to use your palm. Cabbage keeps so well, so if you just cover it in plastic, it stays in your refrigerator for a very long time, which is great. And then some beautiful watermelon radish. It tastes delicious, but also has this really wonderful, vibrant pink color that I just love so much. And if you happen to get a fairly big watermelon radish, I like to just sort of cut it in smaller pieces. I'll put these together in a bowl and get them out of the way for now. So as garnishes as well, we'll be using some sprouts. These are lentils that I sprout at home, which is super easy to do. We have some mixed greens here that I got at the market earlier. And then just to brighten the bowl, again, I want to use as much color just because I just want it to look super beautiful. I got these broccoli rabe edible blossoms. You can use nasturtiums, any other edible flower, just to brighten it up. Of course, we have so much color here, it doesn't need it, but if they're at the market, why not? And lastly, some fresh herbs. I'm gonna be using sorrel. And sorrel is a delicious herb. It's super tart and bright, which I love. It's like super lemony, which I think adds a lot to the bowl. now my vegetables are ready. I'm just gonna tidy up really quickly here before we continue forward. The two different roasted vegetables in two different applications. I'm using the sweet potato as the vegetable for the bowl, and I'm using the carrots to make a sauce. Step four, I'm gonna start the water for the poached eggs. Water takes a little bit to come up to a boil, so I'm gonna start that now so that when we're ready to plate our Dragon Bowl, we'll have our poaching liquid at a nice bowl and we can just drop our eggs. So I'm using a sort of tall 3-quart pot. It's really important that you're using a high surface so that the egg whites cook and they cook upwards and they have that beautiful long sort of tail, and your final product should look like a beautiful teardrop. So I'm gonna fill this up all the way and get it on the burner on high. I'm putting the lid on it so that it retains heat and boils faster. Step 5, make your carrot harissa yogurt. Season your garbanzos. Let's start on making the sauce. Traditionally, harissa is made with roasted red peppers and a lot of great spices. Because red peppers aren't really in season right now, I'm gonna use carrots. They have sort of a very similar flavor palette in the sense that they're sweet. So before we do that, harissa also has a lot of great spice to it. So we're gonna toast some spices and blend them ourselves. Now, if you don't wanna go through that technique, certainly use already ground spices, but I thought it would be fun to sort of show you the process of toasting and blending spices. So we're going to take our small saute pan, and in it we're going to put in a little bit of coriander seed, some cumin seed, a little bit of black peppercorn, and a chili de arbol. Now we're gonna toast these while shaking them constantly. By toasting them, it's going to let out its natural oils, bring out the aroma, and give it a sort of more depth in flavor. I'm gonna bring it on to the burner, and I'm gonna set it on high. Now what's gonna start happening is you're definitely gonna smell this great richness in spices. You don't want to give them a lot of color. That's not what we're looking for. What we're looking for is to warm them up, just to get them going, nudge all those flavors, wake them up. And then after that, we'll put them in the spice grinder. Oh, it smells so, so delicious. They're starting to get a little bit of color. The aroma is definitely there. And grab my spice grinder. Now, if you don't have a spice grinder, I definitely recommend one. They're great. They're great for grinding coffee beans and making your own spice mix, which I think is so important. I really taste the difference when using fresh, roasted, ground spices opposed to spices that are already ground and store-bought. Okay. Press it. Take a little peek. You want to make sure that all the spices are evenly ground, so it needs another minute. Well, maybe less than a minute. Almost there. Great. So once that's done, I'm gonna actually need it another minute. And when it's done, I like to kind of put it upside down so it all sort of travels to the cup. Open up my blender. We're using a Vitamix, which is a really high-powered blender, but really any blender will do. You want to make sure that the carrots are pureed smooth. So I'm going to add my spices to the blender. And while I'm here, I want to show you a nifty trick to cleaning out a spice blender. I'm going to add a piece of bread into here. What's going to happen is the bread is going to get ground up, and it's going to absorb all those trace elements of herbs. Give it a little shake. Turn it upside down, dump the bread. So the bread absorbed all of that herb, and then you're just gonna give it a wipe. And it's ready to go. So let's keep moving on to our sauce. We're gonna take our carrots and put them in the blender. Okay, keep this off to the side. We're going to add some oil. We're going to have water on standby. We're going to gradually add the water just to nudge the carrots along. So we're going to start on low and gradually turn up the speed. See, it's kind of being a little resistant. So at this point, I'm going to just add a little water. And you'll hear it. You'll hear that it's moving better. At that point, you're just going to sort of blast it and let it go until it's really smooth. Check, make sure it's nice and smooth, give it a taste. Mm-hmm. Super smooth. I seasoned it well in the beginning, so I don't need to add any more salt. And I'm going to scrape it out, make sure I get every bit of it. It's got great flavor, great spice to it, great heat. Now this is delicious on its own. If you wanted sort of a vegan element, that's totally fine. It tastes delicious. But today we are going to add just a little bit of yogurt just to give it a wonderful sort of tang and zip to it. So I'm going to just add couple spoonfuls of yogurt and mix it in. You want to make sure it's mixed and well incorporated. It's a beautiful orange color, super bright. Give it a taste. Delicious. Okay.
Now, today we're using canned or packaged cooked garbanzos. I love making my own at home, but for today we're gonna just go ahead and use these. Now, when you buy canned or packaged already made garbanzos, they do need a little bit of love. So what I like to do is drain them. Dump out whatever liquid. And then I'm gonna season them really simply with some oil, a good amount of salt, some lemon, and a pinch of chili. We're gonna stir that up, give it a little taste. And perfect. Maybe just another touch of salt. Great. We're almost ready to go. Step 6, poach turmeric eggs. When I'm poaching eggs, I really, really love to have the eggs sort of look like almost a teardrop shape. And what happens to give it that shape is the bubbles that come from the bottom of the pot rise up and actually shapes the poached egg. So I'm gonna show you that technique now. I'm gonna bring over some vinegar. The vinegar is going to help solidify the whites. Some salt and turmeric right here. I also like to crack my eggs into a cup and then put them into the water. It's a more sort of gentle approach and technique. And a slotted spoon is very important for this as well. Okay, so we're gonna use a good amount of turmeric. I mean, there's so many health qualities in turmeric, but it's also gonna give the eggs a beautiful, bright yellow color. So we're gonna put a good amount of turmeric in there. It's gonna give it great flavor. Then a good amount of salt, also gonna help flavor the eggs. And some vinegar. I'm gonna turn up our heat so that it has the right amount of boil. And we're gonna crack our eggs first into a cup. Now, after adding the spice and the vinegar, it sort of brought down the temperature of the water. So do be patient and make sure you don't drop your egg until it has that really great boil. I like to tell all the young cooks who I'm teaching how to make poached eggs that you want to play around with the heat as if it was like a gas pedal in a car. So you're always moving it, and just to make sure that the boil is strong enough to sort of shape the egg, but also not too strong where you'll risk rupturing the egg. So it's ready. I'm gonna gently drop the egg in there. I'm gonna make two, and I'm gonna work fairly quickly. Now the boil is pretty high, so I'm gonna turn it down. After you've dropped the eggs, you wanna set your timer for 2 minutes. You want to really avoid moving the water at this point. Play with your heat. Make sure you have that perfect simmer going.
and you want to fight any temptation of putting your spoon in there and sort of fidgeting with it before your 2 minutes are up, because you'll risk poking them and breaking them. Always playing with your fire. You're gonna have a plate, so once you pull them off, you can transfer them into your work area. So the this sort of way of cooking them in a flavorful broth really comes from this classic French way of poaching eggs, which they would tend to make them in a red wine, so they would have this beautiful burgundy color. I decided to play with other colors, and we came up with using turmeric, and they're really delicious, and they really, really look beautiful. They're almost ready. Another half minute or so. And then you're gonna sort of follow the top of the whites and gently fish out your poached egg. So you see there's sort of has a tail. And follow the egg whites and you'll find your egg. Turn this baby off. You can turn your oven off if you haven't already done so. And now we're ready to plate. So I'm gonna bring my eggs, my rice. And that's the luxury of making it in a rice cooker. It sets itself off when done. Step 7, assemble. Great, so I'm gonna find some beautiful bowls. So I'm gonna start with the sauce. I'm gonna take a few spoonfuls, angle my bowl so it's on the side, and then just give it a nice swipe around. Again, 2 spoonfuls on an angle, and then give it a beautiful swipe around. Our coconut grains are ready. I'm gonna put a nice spoonful of them in the middle. And then gradually start putting together the bowl. So what I love to do is start working around the bowl. Sweet potato. And every item of the Dragon Bowl should have its time to shine. So it's sort of like a little spot in the bowl. You want to see every element of it because the colors just work so great together. We're going to do our raw vegetables, red cabbage, watermelon radish, some of our greens. Okay, we're gonna add these beautiful greens that we got at the market, and our garbanzos. Gently pick up our egg, put it off to the side a bit. Seeds on top. So I like to put the garnishes sort of on the top, sort of as little crown jewel pieces here. The beautiful pickle looks so gorgeous. It adds so much.
to your bowl. And then we're gonna finish it off with our sprouts. Again, every element should have its own little sort of place in the bowl, not covered by anything. Our beautiful blossoms, I like to just kind of sprinkle them throughout. And then, last but not least, some delicious sorrel. The sorrel is super lemony and bright. If they're long, you can cut them throughout. And then, as a final touch, you're gonna just put a little bit of oil. A squeeze of lemon. And a little bit of salt just to tie everything together. So they're now all done. Thank you so much for cooking along with me and making this delicious dragon bowl that's meant to inspire and show you a bunch of different techniques that you can master at home. There's the sweetness of the sweet potato and the coconut grains, the brightness of the carrot harissa and the vegetables, the crunchiness of the seeds and the garbanzo beans. This is really how I love to eat. Just a lot of great different flavors, a lot of beautiful color. Thank you so much for joining me on this cook-along. I commend you for taking up all these different techniques and for cooking along with me. I hope you had as much fun as I did.
Be sure to like and subscribe, check us on Instagram, and download the Project Foodie app on the iOS App Store.